Welcome to episode 4 in my Workspace Redesign series. I'm Anna, I'm a licensed architect based in Europe. I'm currently in the process of redesigning my workspace, and in this video, I'll share with you how I measure a room. I will talk about the tools, but more importantly, I will talk about which measurements to take, why they matter, and where in the design process you will need them. I'm also going to show you the best way to sketch dimensions on the floor plan. So if you're interested, let's get into this. The tools I have used are the laser distance meter. It works great if you work alone and if you are working in large rooms. I used it everywhere I could, but in the few places where I couldn't, like measuring the span of the door, for example, I used the measuring tape. To write down dimensions, you will need a floor plan of the room, something like this. If you use a pen and paper, I recommend having multiple copies of the floor plan so that you can separate the dimensions. If you don't, the dimensions will end up overlapping each other and you'll have a hard time understanding what they represent. I ended up using 5 different floor plans. If you don't have a plan of your room, you can just watch episode 3 in this series, where I show you how to sketch your room by eye. I also used 2 photos of my windows to write down the measurements. Not everything can be explained clearly on a floor plan. Sometimes a view makes dimensions easier to understand. Particularly in conversations with contractors, this would be very, very useful. Alright, so what should you measure first? Overall dimensions of the room. In the beginning, I am interested in understanding the extremities of my space in all directions. How long, how wide, and how tall it is. And if the walls have any protrusions or niches, I want to know where those are too. Why do I need these measurements? All my dimensions will be useful first and foremost to draw my floor plan and connected drawings in scale. But what I will find it most useful for is just to grasp an understanding of the size of furniture I can put in. Imagine buying a new sofa only to find out it's longer than your longest wall. That would be quite a challenge. These dimensions also help you figure out how much material you'll need, how much paint or wallpaper, so you don't end up spending more than necessary or running short halfway through the project. So if you look at my floor plan, I drew one dimension for the length, one for the width, and I have marked the room height with RH 330 centimeters. Funny enough, because my house is over 100 years old, one wall is 2 centimeters longer than the other. So one wall is 483.6 centimeters and the other is 481. If you live in an old house, don't assume that your walls are parallel to each other. Measure each of them just to be sure. Next to each of my overall dimensions, I have a second dimension line marking the protrusions and niches of each wall. You can see one here, and one here. I added the second one here because the depth of the wall on one side is different than the other. Make sure you measure all the walls. Number 2, floor dimensions left by the baseboard. My second floor plan concerns the dimensions left on the floor within the baseboard. This is a rental, so I'm not 100% sure I'm going to change the baseboard, which means that any furniture resting on the floor, like a chair, a table, a couch, a wardrobe, will have to fit within the area left by the baseboard, not the area between the walls. This information will also be important to me if I want to add a carpet of any kind. As you can see, I have marked the baseboard with a thicker line along the walls, just to be better acquainted with where it is and isn't present along the walls. Fun fact, for example, it is not present in front of my windows, probably because there is already a wood panel there. But I would not have noticed had I not taken a closer look. And just like the previous floor plan, I have drawn dimension lines both for the overall length, width of the floor, as well as a second dimension line to mark the places where the baseboard changes direction. Number 3. Doors and windows. Because both the doors and the windows in my room come with thick frames, I'm also interested in knowing where they start, where they end, and what is the length of the wall between them. Why do I need to know where the frames are located? Because I want the furniture I choose to sit flush between the frames and not cover the frames. If I want to install shelves, if I want to create custom furniture, knowing where the frame ends and the wall starts is very important. I'm also interested in the exact location of the doors and windows in the room to understand the natural flow of movement and the areas that are left between them. For this floor plan, I have sketch the frames in red so I can distinguish them from the wall. You can see them both at my doors and my windows. To measure them, I have drawn a dimension line along each of the walls that have a door or a window. You can see one here, and one here. If we look, for example, at my entryway door, I have marked the door frames with 11 centimeters, as well as the opening of the door in between them. I'm also interested in the length of wall left on each side of the door. So you can see that on the left side I have 151.9 centimeters and on the right 146.3 centimeters. The same goes for the windows. I'm interested in knowing both what the thickness of the frames is, which in my case is 15 centimeters each, but also the window opening and the wall in between. I also want to know what the window sill height is in case I want to place a bench or a table by the window. I do not want a piece of furniture to cover my windows. And when it comes to the doors, I'm interested in the clearance height of the doors. This is the empty space created by the door underneath its frame. I'm also interested in the total height of the door, including its top frame, so I have marked the frame height as well. The clearance height is useful to know if you want to bring bulky furniture at home. Sometimes there are bulky pieces of furniture like a couch, a piano, or a wardrobe that simply do not fit through the door, so knowing how tall your door is would be very useful in these cases. The overall height of the door is important to me when designing the view of the wall, but I'll show you more about this in later videos. The radiators. For our fourth plan, I have marked the radiators. This plan will be particularly useful if you intend to add curtains. Knowing where the radiators are is going to help you find the right distance from the wall for them. But it can also be useful if you want to add any custom piece of furniture, like a bench or a storage element that goes around the radiators. So on my floor plan, I have sketched the radiators, and I have one dimension line marking the length of each of the radiators, as well as the distance left between them and on each side. I'm also interested in their width and their distance from the wall. But this plan is very limited in the information that it gives me. I don't know for sure how tall the radiators are or how far above the floor they're hanging. I also don't know how tall my windows are or how long my curtains should be or where I might fix them. So for that, we have an additional drawing with the view of the windows. Here I mark the height of the room as well as the overall width of the wall. But I use a second and a third dimension line to get more granular about my dimensions and mark the distance between the radiator and the windowsill or the floor, as well as the distance between the window and the ceiling. I also mark the width of the windows as well as the dimension left between the window and the walls. This kind of drawing is going to help me create a strategy about my curtains or any other window treatments I might consider. If I want to add wall art or shelves or any kind of custom furniture on this wall, this kind of drawing will be very, very useful. And if you guys enjoyed this video so far, I hope you'll consider subscribing. It helps me continue making great content like this one. The electrical elements in the room. My final plan is about marking the electrical elements in the room. Why do I need to know where they are? The reason you want to know where they are is to ensure that furniture doesn't block them, and to plan for electronics like TVs, lamps, or appliances. Also, they're often forgotten when measuring rooms, and you would be surprised how many times they get covered by bulky furniture pieces. Also, if you plan to move or remove certain electrical outlets, knowing where the current ones are is going to be very useful. So if you look at my floor plan, I have created a small legend for myself on the upper part where I have marked the different types of electrical elements on my floor plan. We have a red square to mark the sockets, a green one for the light switches, two types of blue for TV and internet, one for the thermostat, and one circle for the ceiling lamp. This will help me understand better what kind of electrical elements I'm looking at and where in the room they are located. What also interests me about these devices is their height from the ground and the distance to the closest wall or door. This will give me a more precise idea about where in the wall they are located. Electrical elements located over each other on the wall, like a light switch and a socket, I have placed in a line perpendicular to the wall they are located on. I think this is pretty easy to understand. Additionally, I also want to know their height on the wall. So I have measured the upper edge of each electrical element and wrote next to it the distance between this upper edge and the ground. So you can see on my floor plan that the sockets are about 34 to 34.5 centimeters away from the ground, while the light switches are 113 and 115 centimeters away from the ground. Taking precise measurements might seem tedious, but it's the foundation of any successful home project. By following these steps, you'll have all the information you need to create a high-quality design. By the way, if you enjoyed this video and you want a written summary of it, I have created a free PDF which you can download from the